Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be decided by what his ears hear, but the righteousness shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the root of the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young shall lie down together. And the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Give us your spirit, O God.
reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Whatever is written in former days was written for our instructions, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the Lord and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth in God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who raises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Mm-hmm. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were coming out to him, and all the region along the Jordan. And they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. I have had three really distinct experiences with the wilderness in my life. The first one, when I was about 12 years old. A few years before that, my grandparents had moved from the wilds of Green Bay to the wilds of Sun City, Arizona. And that was in the days of letters. And my grandmother would write constantly about how she was discovering how beautiful the desert was and how striking it was. Well, I think I was 13 at the time, and my parents, we had four kids in our family, so taking us all down to Arizona didn't happen all the time, but one year we all went down for Christmas. And my grandmother announced the day after Christmas we were gonna drive up into the mountains and drive through the desert. And we thought, oh good, camels, Bedouins, you know, things that you see. that you see in the desert. And as we drove through it, I remember thinking, my God, this is boring. I think Grandma's lost her mind. It's just like sand and cactuses. Well, that was a 13-year-old's understanding of the wilderness. The second really profound encounter with the wilderness I had was actually on my 18th birthday. I was an exchange student, and I was living in Australia. And over the May holidays, we took a camping trip into the dead center of Australia, and we encountered Ayers Rock. Now, you've probably seen it on TV or in travelogues or something. It is a stone monolith that rises 1,200 feet out of a pretty flat desert. It's 2 miles long. It's 5 miles round. It's massive. And it's sacred ground to the Uluru. It's called Uluru now, not Ayers Rock, because it's sacred to the Aborigines. And on this trip, we had an Aboriginal guide. And one night, we were sitting at a fire, and sunset was starting to happen. And we were staring at this rock. Our campsite was about a mile away from it. And we watched as it went from red to blaze orange to shades of purple that I had never imagined. And quietness settled over the desert. And we sat there, and listen to this man talk to us about the ancient spirits that surrounded this place. And I remember thinking, my God, the desert is beautiful. And then the third experience that I had that really sticks in my mind about the wilderness happened about 4 weeks ago. 18 people, including myself, were traveling on a bus in Israel through the Judean wilderness. And we were on our way out to visit the site where John the Baptist baptized people in the River Jordan. The Judean countryside is wild. The highway that we were on ran parallel to the Jordan River, and you could see it from time to time. It was about a mile away most of the time. And between us and the river were fields that were nourished each year when the river overflowed its banks. It was a place where there were avocado groves and olive groves and other produce being grown. But on the other side of the highway was the Judean wilderness. It was a desert, sand, rock outcrops, desolation. It was hotter than blazes. And you see an occasional tree maybe growing up out of the crack in a rock, but that was it. And it might have been, I think it was, as I look back at that trip, the trip to the river was one of the most powerful experiences of the pilgrimage. And Yuval, our guide, he was great. And as we approached several of these sacred spots, these holy sites, he would say something like, now keep in mind, it might not have happened exactly right here. It might have happened over there. Maybe it happened over there. But rest assured, it happened, and it happened right around here. And you felt that. There were people from all over the world, some dressed in blue jeans and t-shirts, some dressed in incredibly ornate native attire, some dressed in baptismal gowns, all coming down to the river to be baptized or to renew their baptismal vows. In that spot, right around here, the people of Israel cross over into the promised land. And this spot, right around here, is where John baptized Jesus. Now we traveled to the site in an air-conditioned luxury coach. In Jesus' time, they walked. Where John baptized is actually about 60 miles away from Jerusalem. When we hear scripture, I think sometimes we think, oh, maybe they had a quick trip out with a picnic in the afternoon and came back that night. But that wasn't so. It was 60 miles, at least a three-day walk, down twisting mountain roads from Jerusalem, and through the scorching heat of the Judean desert. It was not a casual trip at all, but people flocked there. 2,000 years ago, people flocked to the river to see him. And 2,000 years later, tens of thousands of people still flock to the river every year. That same spot where it happened right around here. We heard this morning once again about John the Baptist, the voice crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. And we heard that the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to be baptized by him in the river. They went out to encounter John in the wilderness. Last week in the gospel reading, we heard Jesus talking about John and the encounters that people had. And he asked, what did you go out to the wilderness to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not that, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, people who dress in fine clothes live in palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet. And yes, I tell you, more than a prophet, the one about whom is written, I will send my messenger ahead of you. They traveled out in the wilderness to see John. And during the season of Advent, the church invites us also to travel into the wilderness and to ask in our hearts, where are we on our journey? Where are we in relationship to God? We're so often weighed down by things on our journey. Big things out in the world, the state of the economy, violence we see on the news, the environment, elections, the weather, all things that are beyond our ability to change. They're distractions, really. Distractions from ourselves, distractions from our deepest thoughts, distractions from our shortcomings, distractions from sin. We are worried about many things, and the church invites us again to go into the desert and to hear the words of the prophet, repent, reform ourselves. The Greek word, and this is one of those important places where the Greek word actually makes a difference, the Greek word that we translate as repent or reform is metanoia. Meta, change, like a morphic shift. And noia, thoughts, our thoughts, the word from which paranoia, twisted thoughts, comes from. And you put them together, metanoia, and it means change our thoughts. Change how we think. I think we often think of repentance as changing behavior, but it's really more than that. True repentance is changing how we think. John's message was in two parts. One, repent, metanoia, because two, the kingdom of God is at hand. And John explains to us in his own way that the kingdom of God is not a place. The kingdom of God is a person that has drawn near. The kingdom of God is not a what, it is a who. And that who is Jesus. John tells us, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John is directing our attention to a fundamental change of mind. And John is directing us to Jesus. Jesus, in whom divinity and humanity are joined. Jesus, in whom heaven and earth have come together. Jesus, in which a new way of thinking has appeared. The people came to the desert to hear John's message. And in Advent, we are remembered of it once again to change our thoughts and to open our minds and our eyes and our hearts and our ears to see the kingdom that is being ushered in. In Advent, we are encouraged to leave behind the distractions that separate us from the kingdom, from the who, from God. Deep down, we know that we are all imperfect. Deep down, people of good conscience, people of all faiths, seek a better way to live, a better way to be. Deep down, we seek a sort of spiritual clarity, a sense of purity. People look for it all over the place. People stream to all kinds of deserts to find inner peace, therapists, psychologists, meditation, New Age practices, spiritual gurus, Judge Judy. We all stream to places to find clarity in our lives. We all stream to the desert because we need to find what the desert offers, inner peace, fulfillment, self-worth. And for Christians, we find this in Jesus. We stream to the desert to find Jesus. And to find Jesus, we undertake this process of metanoia when we change our thinking. In my home office, I have a small wall hanging. I think I've said this before. And on this hanging, it tells us how metanoia works. And it says, and you maybe have heard this, watch your thoughts, watch your noia, watch your thoughts, for they become your words. Watch your words because they become your actions. Watch your actions because they become your habits. And watch your habits for they become your character. And watch your character for it becomes your destiny. Our destiny is life eternal with God. And the road to our destiny, our road to the through the wilderness, begins with how we think. Advent is a season that begins with metanoia, with changing our thoughts. So this week, as we go out into the world, the church invites us to embrace metanoia, to embrace the coming of the kingdom, the coming of Jesus. The church invites us to change our thoughts. Thoughts, words, actions, habits, character, destiny. Advent starts right here, right in our head, right in our thoughts.
Words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In our prayers today, we remember the church around the world. We pray for Jeffrey, our bishop, and the Standing Committee of the Diocese. We pray for the Dean, the Chapter, the staff, and the trustees of the Cathedral Corporation. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we remember the Episcopal Church of Jerusalem and the Middle East. We remember the people and clergy of St. John's Cathedral, and the people and clergy of our companion diocese in Nuala in Tanzania. Remember all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, including those on our parish prayer list: Polly, Terry, Glenn, Maggie, Martha, Sonia, Pat, Judy, Isabel, Bob, Carol, Betty, Noel, and Renee. We remember those who celebrate birthdays this week, including Roland Callen, and those celebrating anniversaries. And we remember those who have died. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them to the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you." Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life.
Amen.
And God's peace be with you all. Good morning, everyone. Just one quick announcement with many parts. How about that? This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we have lessons and carols, which is really one of my favorite services of the church year. It's such a beautiful, peaceful way to start out the Advent season. And one of the real true joys of my job is that I get to sit in my office and listen to this incredible music being made. During the week, I get to listen to Lee practicing. Maybe he knows, but sometimes I sneak over and open the door so I can hear it better. And for this last week, I've been able to hear the choir practicing, and they're stupendous. They're awesome. Lessons and Carols is one of those services where you can invite people to church just for a purely joyful way of being church in another way, to bring people in to hear beautiful music, to hear readings from Scripture, and then to feast afterwards at the reception. So if you're not coming this afternoon, change your plans and come. And if you are coming, bring a friend. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Supper. Thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemptional Father in this sacrifice of praise and thanks, recalling his death and resurrection and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you constancy and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom.
All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. May Almighty God, by whose providence our Savior Christ came among us in great humility, sanctify you with the light of his blessing and set you free from all sin. May he, whose second coming in power and great glory we await, make you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love. May you who rejoice in the first advent of our Redeemer at his second advent be rewarded with unending life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore.
Amen.